Man, did you hear him finally admit that he's the chief among sinners? Did you hear that? That's recorded. I knew it. Tony started us several weeks ago on lack of Bible character. We started with A, B, C. We're finally up to G, and we're going to be talking about Gehazi tonight. We're trying to pick guys that we don't really know much about so that we can learn about them as we go. If you remember, Elisha? So Elijah, you remember Elijah in the showdown at Mount Carmel and the sacrifices and all sorts of miracles Elijah did. And Elisha was his sidekick, his what? Yeah, like his understudy. That's exactly right, like his understudy. And did Elijah die? Do you remember? He didn't die. The Lord just took him up. Yeah. And if you remember the last day of Elijah's life on earth, Elisha wouldn't leave his side. And Elijah kept saying, I'm going to go to this place, stay here. No, I'm not going to leave you. And then Elijah would say, okay, now I'm going to go to this place, stay here. No, I'm not going to leave you. Because he knew what was going to happen. One of the servants went up to him and said, do you know that the Lord is taking your master tonight or today? And he said, I know, just be quiet about it, be quiet. And then Elijah said, before he went, what can I give you? When I leave here, what can I give you? And look, you are on, Marcella, you are on a double portion of your spirit, of the spirit. And he said, I don't know if it's going to be given to you or not. If you see me when I'm taken up, then you got it. And if you don't, then you didn't get it and you should have asked for a puppy. Because maybe you would have gotten that one. He said, it's a tough thing you're asking for. And then Elisha saw Elijah when he got taken up. This is right at the beginning of 2 Kings. I think it was right at the beginning of 2 Kings where all this happened. And then right away, so Elisha takes the cloak and he hits the water and it splits the water. And just miracle after miracle. There was some water where a town couldn't survive because the water was bad. And Elisha put some salt in it and said, the Lord says that this water will always be good from this point on. And then it was good. Then we see Elisha. This is one of the scary stories of the Bible. This is one of those what stories of the Bible. Do you remember some kids made fun of Elisha? Do you remember? Do you remember what they made fun of?
Yes, I do.
Yeah, Tony does. Tony has a little sensitivity in this regard. But Baldy. They were calling him Baldy. Now, what would a man of God generally do if a bunch of teenagers are called? This is one of those really difficult passages in the Bible. Elisha was a man of God, and the Holy Spirit used him and was evident all over him and all through his life. The kids were calling him Baldy. Do you remember what happened? Two bears came down and killed the 42 kids. Teenagers. All the moms are laughing. But that's harsh. Okay, so that happened before, I think just two chapters before. Okay, so I think that was in 2 Kings 3. Then in 2 Kings 4, there's a Shumanite, I think I said that right, a Shumanite woman, a well-to-do woman, the Bible says, where every time Elisha would come into town, she would feed him. And she said to her husband, you know, this man of God comes into town often. Let's set up a room for him. And she took really good care of her. And Elisha said once, you know, what can I give you? How can we repay you? What can I do? And she said, oh, no, I live among my own people. Like, I'm fine. I'm content. I don't need anything. And he asked Gehazi, the servant, what can we give this woman? And Gehazi said, well, she doesn't have a son. And he said, perfect. What a great gift. And I don't know. I have to think about that one. You know, give me an option on that. But they gave it, so he told her, I think the next day, this time next year, you're going to be holding a son. And she's like, oh, don't tease me. Don't tease me. And he said, no, serio, it's going to happen. Serio, promise it. And and so she had a son. And then the son got sick. Several years had passed. He was out, I think, in the woods with his dad. And he said, my head. And the dad took him and gave him to a servant and said, take him to his mother. Took him to his mother, and in his mother's arms, he died. So then the mother got the kid, put it in Elisha's bed. You know how he had a room. She had set up a room. Put it in Elisha's bed, the dead boy, and said, I'm going to the man of God. They said, it's not Sunday. It's not church day. Why are you going to go to the man of God? And she said, just get me on a donkey and get me to the man of God. As she was going to Elisha, he saw her, and he said, oh, the Shumanite woman. Let's go see what she needs. And she went to reach for the ankles of Elisha, and Gehazi stopped her. He's like, don't stop her. You know, see what she needs. And she said, oh, I told you not to tease me. I told you not to get my hopes up with a son. Now my son has died. And he gave his staff to Gehazi. Again, we're talking about Gehazi. Gave his staff to Gehazi, and he said, run as fast as you can. Like, time really matters to God. You know, like 2 minutes is going to make any difference. I mean, Lazarus was dead for a couple of days. Or how many days? 5 days? Because he already stunk by then. 3 days or 5 days? Three, you think? Two? One, two? Oh, bingo! And so he said, take this staff and put it on the child's face. Okay, so he said, don't stop, don't talk to anybody along the way, Gehazi, just do what I say. So he took the staff, and of course, since Elisha said what to do, of course it's going to work. He puts it on his face, and it didn't work. So Gehazi is putting the staff on the kid's face, just like Elisha said. Nothing happened. So he went back to his master, and he said, nothing happened. I did exactly what you said. So then Elisha went, and it's like he laid down on the kid three times. I don't know. Maybe we'll call that CPR. Face to face. I know. Foot to foot, face to face. I mean, just creepy. I hope that wasn't on video or something, or he'd be in prison, but... The kid, then it says the kid sneezed 7 times, and then he woke up. Weird stuff, but that's how it happened. That was in 2 Kings chapter 4. 2 Kings chapter 5, Naaman, I don't know if you remember Naaman. Naaman was like the chief, he was the commander of the Syrian army. You know Syria now, with President Assad and at war with Israel. Everyone's at war with Israel, but you know how Syria hates Israel and they're constantly fighting? Well, it was the same way in these times. The Syrians were fighting the Israelites, but Naaman had it, the Bible calls it leprosy, but they use that word, the Bible used that word for any kind of skin disease, something, you know, so some people say it was psoriasis, who knows what it was, but some sort of skin disease. Naaman had, we'll just call it leprosy because that's what the Bible calls it. Naaman had leprosy, and Naaman's wife's servant girl said, oh, if he would only go to Israel and see the prophet would be able to heal him of this skin condition. Well, the Syrians hated Israel, and Israel hated the Syrians, so it was already this really difficult situation. And the servant girl, Tony and I were talking about this earlier, this is horrible, but you know where that servant girl came from? She had been kidnapped from Israel. That's how she knew about Elisha. So that's just a weird system. And I mean, so she was just kidnapped, kind of like Daniel was kidnapped. She was kidnapped, taken out of her home, taken out of her country to Naaman's house, and she became the pet, the servant of Naaman's wife. But again, I mean, it's weird because these kids that were kidnapped, they still seem to have good attitudes towards the people that had kidnapped them. So I don't know, maybe it was just kind of that culture. You know how slavery, when we talk about slavery, we think of slavery in America's day, but it was a different kind of slavery where it was more like being a maid or being someone that lived in the home, and they were taken care of, and sometimes they were taken very good care of, and they would choose to stay there forever. So maybe it was that, but I don't know. But one way or the other, she was kidnapped. The Bible says she was kidnapped. I mean, that she was taken captivity during one of these battles between Syria and Israel. Anyway, she said, oh, if he would only go to the prophet, he could heal him. And Naaman did it. Naaman went to the president of Syria. Naaman was very well respected by the president. I mean, this was a big guy. This was an important guy. And he went to the Syrian president and said, I want to go to Israel and go to this prophet to see if he can heal my skin condition. And he sent him with, oh, I don't remember, like 10 talents of silver and 60 shekels of gold. It was like hundreds of thousands, if not millions of dollars worth of silver and gold, and 10 garments. I guess garments were a big thing, because remember when Achan stole the silver and gold, he also stole garments. So I guess the clothing was a big thing. But he had 10 changes of clothes, 10 garments, I guess important garments, and literally hundreds of thousands of dollars, if not millions of dollars worth of money, to take to this prophet to heal this chief commander. Naaman went to, the Syrian president wrote a letter to the Israeli president and said, I'm sending my chief commander, please heal him. And the Israeli president said, what? I'm not God, I can't heal this guy. Oh, great, now we're going to be at war again because he's sending all this money for us to do something that I can't do. And Elisha said, what are you so upset about? Send him to me. I'll take care of it. He will see that God, the God of Israel, is the one and only true God. So they went to Elisha's place, and did Elisha come down and talk to him and come down and say, I'm going to heal you? What did Elisha do? He sent the servant out and said, and we think Gehazi. Gehazi is the only servant of Elisha's that's ever named by name. So we assume that when it says the servant of Elisha, he was the one. He was the right-hand man for Elisha. Kind of like Elisha was the right-hand man for Elijah. Gehazi, although he was a servant, he was the right-hand man of Elisha. And Elisha didn't even come out and meet the celebrity. Didn't even come out and meet this incredibly powerful man. And he just sent a servant out and said, go dip yourself in the funky Rio Grande River 7 times and you'll be healed. And what did Naaman say? We have better rivers in Syria that I could have dunked myself in. So did he say, oh, I'm so thankful that this is such an easy thing? Or he was mad because he wasn't treated with the respect that he thought he deserved. He said, well, I figured Elisha would have at least come down and he would have prayed to his God. I would have thought he'd be Pentecostal. He'd pray to his God and he'd wave his hand over. That's what he said. I figured he'd wave his hand over my skin and then the skin lesions would go away. And he was so mad. He was so insulted and he stormed off. And then what happened? Yeah, his servant. Again, now Naaman, Naaman, I don't want to say he was a humble guy, but he listened to this servant girl of his wife's, and now he listened to his own servant. He didn't say, shut up, servant. I am the chief commander of the army of Syria. Don't you tell me what to do. His servant said, you know, if Elisha would have told you to do something very difficult, wouldn't you have done it? He has told you to do something easy. Give it a shot. Check it out. So he went. He went to the Rio Grande, the Jordan, and he dunked himself 7 times, and when he came up out of the water, he said he had the skin like a young boy, and he was healed because he listened. And then Naaman went back to Elisha. He didn't have to do this. I mean, we see a lot of kind of humility or what appears to be humility. We see a lot of sensitivity to Naaman that we're not going to see from Gehazi in a minute, which is kind of a sad commentary. But he went back to Elisha. He didn't have to. I mean, he was already ticked at Elisha for not showing him respect. He didn't have to go back to Elisha. He went back to Elisha, and he said, please let me give you. We brought all of this money, all of these garments, just to show our gratitude. Please accept this. And what did Elisha say? No. Can you imagine the TV preacher saying no to that?
Oh, no, that would never happen.
No, it's like, oh, that's your seed money. The Lord will bless you tenfold. You give me that seed money and you'll get 100-fold if you only have faith. He said, no, I won't. Please let us give you money. I mean, you would think just for peace among the, you know how somebody wants to give you something and sometimes you feel like, oh, it means a lot to them to give me something. That way they don't feel like they owe me. Okay, you can give that to me. Okay, we're friends. And he said, no. He was making it clear God can't be bought and I'm not doing this for money. I am showing you that the God of Israel is the one and only true God, and he healed you, not me. And I don't need your money. I have the God of Israel. I have the creator of this universe as my father. I don't need your silver and your gold. And he sent Naaman on his way. And Naaman said, one thing. And I like this about Naaman too, the sensitivity. He said, if you won't take my blessings, if you won't take the money, could you please give me enough dirt that 2 mules could carry, because I will never sacrifice or do burnt offerings to any god except for the one true God, which is your God of Israel. Could you please just send me the dirt so that I can worship the one true God on his dirt? And he sent him with the dirt. He said, but one more thing, Elisha. Again, he was mad at Elisha before, and now he's like asking favors. Elisha, please forgive me of one thing. When the king, when we go to bow down to this idol, I mean, we can see now that Naaman was basically almost like the head of idolatry in Syria, because he said, when the king goes to bow down to this idol, I'm right beside him and he holds my arm and I have to bow with him. Will you please forgive me that one thing? And what did Elisha say? Go in peace. I don't know. I kind of like that. It's almost like, you know, I just got saved, but I drive liquor trucks. But that's just my job right now, and I'm trying to do something different, but this is just the situation I'm in. Please forgive that one thing. The sensitivity to say that. But he said, go in peace. And Naaman came out. Ladies, I'm over here. Ladies. He said, he came out, and his skin looked like a young boy. And Elisha said, go in peace. And all the ladies said, yes, he did. Go in peace. But because Marcella can't keep her eye off this and on me, you can go ahead and go to the next slide, and we'll give something that, all right, now that's more appropriate for church. Marcella, I'm sorry. But that's the story. So then Gehazi comes in. Now, and so in your study guide, on the left-hand side of your study guide, we have go in peace. So everything I just told you isn't there yet. That's the first part of chapter 5. And then everything we're about to go over on keynote is on the left-hand side of your study guide. But it says in the second half of verse 19, after Naaman had traveled some distance, in the second part of 19, Tony's my keynote guy. Oh, that's okay. I'll yell at Tony, but I won't yell at you, Rachel. You're doing a great job. Back one, if you don't mind. You just got so excited you hit it twice. After Naaman had traveled some distance, Gehazi, the servant of Elisha the man of God, said to himself, my master was too easy on Naaman, this Aramean, by not accepting from him what he brought. He's like, you know what? This guy brought a lot of money. He's an ungodly guy with a ton of money. That money ought to go to us. Oh, it could be used for the ministry, right? Is that what Gehazi was thinking? Yeah, and then he says, as surely as the Lord lives, I will run after him and get something from him. So Gehazi hurried after Naaman. When Naaman saw him running toward him, Naaman got down from his chariot to meet him. Is everything all right? He said. Everything's all right, Gehazi answered, but my master sent me to say. Now, had his master sent him to say anything? Uh-uh. My master sent me to say, two young men from the company of the prophets have just come to me from the hill country of Ephraim. Please give them a talent of silver and two sets of clothing. Now, a talent of silver, from what I read, almost weighs as much as a man of silver. Tony's like, this size man? Maybe a little bit smaller than that size man. Maybe Harvey size man. You know, not quite, you know, I can't win that one. Not quite full man. It was a lot. I mean, thousands of dollars worth of silver. Thousands of dollars worth of silver and a couple of things of clothing. They love clothing. Yeah, that's kind of crazy, huh? They work with sheep and they stayed in tents, but they like their little Armani or... maybe fur coats. Maybe those were the garments. Who knows? And Naaman said, by all means, take two talents. He doubled it. Again, he was so appreciative and so gracious. And he's the unbeliever in this story. He is the ungodly one that bows to idols in this story. By all means, take two talents, said Naaman. He urged Gehazi to accept them. Then he tied up the two talents of silver in two bags with two sets of clothing. He gave them to two of his servants because they had to carry all this weight. And they carried them ahead of Gehazi. They carried these bags of silver ahead of Gehazi. When Gehazi, in verse 24, when Gehazi came to the hill, he took the things from the servants and he put them away in the house and he sent the men away and they left. So he didn't put it in the ministry. He didn't give it to Elisha. He put it in his own living room. He took it, sent the servants away. When he went in and stood before his master, Elisha asked him, where have you been, Gehazi? Your servant didn't go anywhere, Gehazi answered. Verse 26, but Elisha said to him, was not my spirit with you when the man got down from his chariot to meet you? Is this the time to take money or to accept clothes or olive groves or vineyards or flocks and herds or male and female slaves? Is this the time, Gehazi, really? Verse 27, Naaman's leprosy will cling to you and to your descendants forever. Then Gehazi went from Elisha's presence, and his skin was leprous, and it had become as white as snow. He wanted something from from Naaman, but he got something else he didn't quite expect from Naaman. Now, wouldn't that have freaked you out if you're, you know, you go home and your husband says, "Where have you been?" And you're like, "I haven't been anywhere." And he says, "Was not," Jonah just woke up. "Was not my spirit with you when you got out of that car and you're talking to that dude down the street?" And you're like, it's like he's got some I Spy app on my phone and he's watching me. I mean, the Holy Spirit was on him. Now, wouldn't you think that Gehazi would have been a little scared after what Elisha did to the teenagers laughing at him about his bald head? I mean, you'd think he'd at least have a little fear. But Gehazi's desires led to his deception and then ultimately to his disgrace. It started with these desires, and then it turned into deception, and then it ultimately led to his disgrace. So desires, initially, we want something really bad, so we sneak around, just like Gehazi did, and try to get it. Check this video out. Oh, I keep pointing over here because I'm used to the TV being on this side. This is so cute. Can you read it? Is this real? She left all these goodies on the table? I better go be sure. So the dog runs to go see where his mama is. Good, she's going to be working for a while. That's what the dog's really thinking, you know. You know those little crunchy snacks? Like, what are those called? Those fry things? Fries? What are they called? Oh, I don't know. Oh, veggie sticks, yeah. So he goes back and he checks again. Is she still there? Okay, she's still there. I hope I don't eat too loud. He can't reach the plate, apparently. I'm going to call it a he because it's a bad boy. And then he goes, "Better be safe than sorry." He goes back and checks again. And then somebody snuck in and put more clothes. Wait, more goodies on the table? He keeps trying to reach that plate. Funny to hear him chew, huh? And now you see the little legs going in the back? Now his mama comes out. Oh! I'm right here, Mama. I didn't go anywhere. Again, Gehazi's desires led to his deception and led to his disgrace. It started with when we want something, and we've all been there. We can look at Gehazi and think, "Why are you so stupid?" But been there. We want something and we think it's not that big of a deal, but it's a big enough deal that we feel like we have to sneak around for it until we get caught. So it starts with desires. We want and we sneak and then we lie. And that's exactly what we see with Gehazi. Check this out.
In general,
this is funny.
More people claim they watch things like the presidential inauguration than actually do. In fact, we sent a camera out on the Hollywood Boulevard today. We asked people what they thought of the inauguration, even though it hasn't happened yet.
So this is before the inauguration.
This is an event that will take place days from now. So there's no way they could possibly have an opinion on it, but that didn't stop people from having them on tonight's edition of Lie Witness News.
What did you think of the inauguration yesterday?
It was awesome. It was part of history. It was
can
really
you imagine
nice
her watching this on TV later?
In his second term. I'm proud of him.
Did you like his speech?
Yeah, it was from the heart. I really, it was moving. He kind of put a tear to my eye.
Was there anything in particular he said that spoke to you?
I like when he was talking about, what he's going to do for us. Not about the other countries, but what he's going to do for America.
What did you think of the inauguration yesterday?
I didn't really care for it. I didn't care for any of it, really, to be honest. I turned the TV off. It kind of bored me.
Do you like the part where she threw teddy bears into the crowd?
Yes, that was
fun,
great.
Right?
Yes.
What did you think about when Joe Biden cried?
I thought that was a little sentimental, warm. It touched my heart.
What did you think of the inauguration last night?
I don't know. It stinks. I didn't like it.
You didn't like it. Did you enjoy the tap routine?
That's the only thing it was kind of worth it.
It was fine, right?
Yeah, it was okay.
What did you think about the giant cake they gave out?
Oh, that was excellent. That was marvelous. I loved that one. That was the best part about it.
Did you enjoy the juggling routine?
Yeah, I enjoyed everything. And after that, I just went to sleep.
She's just making stuff up. What did you think about all the teddy bears being thrown out to the audience? Oh, that was really nice. What do you think about when Joe Biden cried? Oh, that was so sentimental. What did you think about the tap routine? Well, that was my favorite part. That was the only good part, he said. They're just making it up. They're just embarrassed to say, I didn't care enough about it to watch it, or I'm so behind on the news that I didn't realize it's next week, not yesterday. We want the desire, we want, and we sneak around, then the deception, then we lie about it. That's what Gehazi did, and that's what we've all done at some point or another, the deception, and then ultimately, we get busted. And that's exactly what happened with Gehazi. Check out this kitten. Busted. Oh. Isn't that funny? Just drops it, leaves it alone, starts slowly backing away from the red, fun, playful thing. That's funny. Now, if we're smart, that's what we do. We just drop it, we back up, we leave it alone. But again, Gehazi's desires, which again, this is the same thing that happens to us, led to his deception and then led to his disgrace. But what caused the temptation to be so great? I was thinking about that whenever we prepare for a talk. It's easy to say Gehazi was greedy. Ooh, we'll just call it Gehazi's greed. They both start with G. Don't be greedy. Done. That was quick, huh? Don't be greedy. But, I mean, to get a little deeper into it, what was Gehazi thinking? You know, what made him want this silver and gold so much? I mean, there's got to be more to it than that. So we're going to look at a few quick things. They're on the right-hand side in your study guide, where I have Gehazi's desire led to his deception and then to his defilement. I changed the word to disgrace because I like disgrace better. But then we have Gehazi's contentment, Gehazi's covetousness, so we're going to go through those. So Gehazi's contentment. Again, we're trying to kind of get into the brain of Gehazi to see why he did what he did, because these stories, these events were real. And they happened. And they were recorded. Why were they recorded for us? So we could learn from them. So if we just say, don't be greedy, well, that's easy and that's cool. But if we don't really understand where Gehazi was coming from, we're probably not going to ever relate to him. Oh, okay, don't be greedy. Don't take the garment and the silver and the gold next time Naaman comes with leprosy and wants to be gets dunked in the Jordan River. You know, how can it relate to our lives? So Gehazi's contentment. Tony's told you before about his, goat named Thumper, who used to always want the weeds that were just outside the fence. This isn't Thumper, but I guess animals do that a lot. There was one where two donkeys, there was a story I read about two donkeys that this guy had, and there was a fence in between the two donkeys, and they constantly ate the other one's grass. They would never eat their own. They were always reaching out. And if you look at pictures online, you can always see the animals reaching just beyond the fence. Now, does he have weeds in his little pen? Yes, but he's killing himself. He's going to choke himself to death trying to get the other weeds. Are they like special weeds with Italian dressing on them? No. But we always want what we don't have. Now, Elisha had double the portion of the spirit compared to Elijah, and Gehazi was his right-hand man, and it wasn't enough. He still wasn't content. Now, I wonder, just one chapter before, we don't know in time when it was, one chapter before is where Elisha told Gehazi, go take my staff and lay it on the boy's face, and it didn't work. So maybe Gehazi got resentful. Maybe Gehazi was tired of being the servant, being the second-hand man, being the right-hand eye. You know, I'm just as good as he is. Or why does he get all the credit? Why does he get to heal them, but I can't? Even when he told me to do it, I still couldn't do it. Maybe he just got tired of his position. But instead of appreciating everything he had, he focused on what he didn't have. So Gehazi's contentment, he had very little. We need to learn to be content. Again, we don't want to fall into the same trap that Gehazi did. What about Gehazi's covetousness? What does it mean to be covetous? To want more? Specifically, to want what she has. To want what somebody else has. To want your neighbor's car. To want your neighbor's wife. To want your whatever. Do you think he had the option of getting whatever kind of ice cream cone he wanted? You know he did. And he said, I want the colorful little one. And she said, I want the big white ice cream cone. And then they got it. And then she went, mmm. And he went, aww. Tyler, when Tyler was little, this used to drive me crazy. Grandpa was good about it. But Tyler, whenever we'd go to a restaurant, Tyler would decide what he wanted to eat. This is when he was little. And I'd say, okay, Tyler, think about this. Because you know as soon as Grandpa gets his food, you're going to want his food. So think about what Grandpa's getting. Think about what you're getting. And think about, is that really what you want? He's like, okay, that's what I want. I want the chicken nuggets. And Grandpa gets the steak or the hamburger or the whatever. And then it comes, what happened? Every single time. Every time! Tyler would say, could I have one bite? I was like, oh, Tyler, I told you. And Grandpa would say, it's okay, I don't mind sharing. And it's like, no, it's the principle. I don't want him always wanting yours. I want him to be satisfied with his. Now, hopefully, Tyler's all grown now. Hopefully, he's not like that anymore. I don't know. We don't do that anymore. But Gehazi wanted what Naaman had. That discontented spirit led to the covetous spirit. I want. And he started feeling like he could sell ministry for money. And I think most of the TV preachers really are that way, where they're selling. I mean, really, if you send us $50, we'll send you this faux necklace made of sincere plastic that you can shimmy on your window. Just silly, stupid things. I remember once I called a minister. I wanted, we were doing an Ecclesiastes study. And they said, and I was listening, he comes on it. Well, I shouldn't tell you because then you might know. But he comes on the radio while I'm driving to the office. And they said he was starting Ecclesiastes study. And so I was listening to it, and it was really good. And I thought, you know what? I'm going to call it, and I'm going to get that. And it was a DVD. And so they said, for a gift of any amount, we'll send you this DVD. So I could have called, and I could have said, I'll give you a buck. I'll give you $5. You know, how much does it go? I mean, anybody who ever wants one of our DVDs, how much do we charge? Does anyone know? $10. Yeah, you wish $10. We charge you $10, Marcella. You're the only one we charge $10. $10. If someone says, hey, you know what? My sister would really love a copy of your service. Can you, you know, do you guys have it for sale on DVD? We'll say, oh, we'll burn you a copy right now, and we just give it. Because it costs us about $1 for that little DVD. And some for ink, but it's ministry. Oh my goodness, I mean, would you pay someone to listen to your stuff just so that maybe they'll hear some gospel and get saved? And so I thought, well, $20. I'll send them $20 for the DVD message of whatever I just heard. So I sent them $20 and I got a book. Well, I'd already bought the book on Amazon because it was half the price. So I called them and I said, I had ordered, and it took like 8 weeks to get there. On Amazon, I got it overnight. Okay, come on, ministries, get it together. So I got this book, and I already had the book, and I said, I'm sorry, but I actually ordered the DVD. And they said, oh, yeah, you ordered the DVD, but that was for $50. And I said, what? I said, it said an amount of any kind. Well, the suggested retail, or the suggested thing was $50. And I said, well, shoot, I thought I was being generous sending you $20 for the DVD. I said, so you literally just sent me a book because it wasn't enough for the suggested, but that's what they did. I will never send them money again. And I like the minister. I like the preacher. I think they're, but I didn't appreciate that. Gehazi started feeling like, well, shoot, for this miracle, we ought to get money. If miracles aren't for sale. I mean, Elisha made that clear. But Gehazi, he started seeing that, thinking, ooh, what I could do with that. And this Aramean, I keep saying it wrong, Aramean, he doesn't need that money. He's an ungodly guy, and he's going to go use it on the devil. I'll use it for ministry. He was using it for himself. So Gehazi's contentment, Gehazi's covetousness, Gehazi's concern. These are cute pictures, huh? See the dog with three big old balls in his mouth? Who was Gehazi concerned about? Himself. Was he concerned about Naaman, the unsaved guy who could have had incredible influence in Syria, an ungodly nation? He was the right-hand man to the king of Syria. It would be like, who's that basketball player who's like the crazy one? Dennis Rodman, who's like the best friend now of, yeah, the BFF of Kim, gosh, sorry, I'm not using the right lingo, the BFF of Kim Jong-il. Yeah, it would be like having that kind of influence and being able to lead him to the Lord. I don't think that's what Dennis Rodman's doing. Maybe he's working on his wardrobe and his piercings, I don't know. Imagine having that kind of influence. Imagining being able to influence someone with such high power, not for your own benefit, but for the Lord. And instead of thinking about Naaman, instead of thinking about all of Naaman's servants who are lost and dying and going to hell, instead of just having honor for Elisha and saying, you know, if Elisha thought it was best, then okay, it's not my call. But he didn't. His only concern was himself and how many balls can I fit in my mouth? That was his only concern. All right, Gehazi's complacency. Honestly, I think this is where it all stems from, is Gehazi's complacency. I think, what is that phrase? Familiarity breeds contempt. When you get so familiar with something, you just don't really appreciate it anymore. You know what I mean? It's like when you're dating someone, and and you'll do anything for them, and they say something funny or bad, or they say something wrong, and you give them the benefit of the doubt, but then you get married, and then you wake up with them every single day. I mean, not me. He's not listening anyway. He's saying goodbye to Teresa, so I can say whatever I want. But, you know, you just aren't as nice anymore. They say things, and it's not as funny anymore, and, you know? Familiarity breeds contempt. And when we look at Elisha's life and Gehazi's life being his right-hand man, we think, what did he have to complain about? What in the world did he want with silver and gold and a garment? He had Elisha as his BFF. I got it. I'm with you now, sister. Now, I'm BFFs with Elisha, who has double the spirit of Elijah. What in the world could I want with silver and gold? But I think that in ministry, we just kind of get used to things and we don't recognize what we have right in front of us. And I think this is what caused the whole downward spiral. He was just hanging out like this cat laying on the porch thinking, I'm bored. I'm tired of being the servant. And there's got to be more to life than this. Because if you're not looking for more, then the silver and the gold wouldn't have even caught his eye. It didn't catch Elisha's eye. He said, you know what? Ministry to Naaman and ministry to Syria is far more important. Let's show them our gracious God. And let's show them that we can't be bought and our God can't be bought. But he wasn't concerned about any of that. Again, he was just concerned about himself and he got complacent with this incredible position he had. And instead, he just tried to get more. And all of that led ultimately to Gehazi's condemnation. That's where, again, he wanted something from Naaman, the silver and the gold. He got something else that Naaman had, which was his leprous skin condition. Not only him, but for all of his descendants forever. Who knows? I mean, you know how some people do. Some people get psoriasis, some people don't. Some people get different things, and we say, oh, it runs in families. It's probably all his fault. It's probably all his fault because we all came from the same gene pool. We're cousins. Rick just woke up. Ultimately, it led to Gehazi's condemnation. So if we could keep control, I think, of our contentment, our covetousness, our concern, and our complacency, maybe we could prevent condemnation. This was given to us to learn so that we can think, and we all do this. We can look down our nose on Gehazi all day long, but we all feel like the grass is greener on the other side. Oh, if I were just in school. Oh, if I just had this job. Oh, if I just had this guy. Oh, if I could just get rid of this guy. We all, no kidding. The grass is always greener and we're never content. How much money do we want to make? Being honest, how much money do we want to make? A little bit more. Do I wish we made more money? Absolutely. Absolutely. Do I wish more money came in the church? Absolutely. Do I wish you made more money? Yes, absolutely. Now, so I put on the next slide, quit looking for more. Now, this is kind of two-sided, so stay with me. There's nothing wrong with ambition. drive and goals. Is there anything wrong with me trying to make more money? No? Is there anything wrong with me trying to have a better career or a better job or a better paycheck or a stronger family? Is there anything wrong with any of that? Nothing. Nothing. Nothing is wrong with any of that, but we should still find satisfaction in whatever situation we're in. And that's that fine line. I think that's where we fall through the crack. Because we say, you know, there's nothing, especially in America, you know, it's the American dream. And there's nothing wrong with it. I think everybody, I mean, I remember when I was a nursing student, there was a nurse. She said, I was getting ready to start medical school. And she said, oh, I've always wanted to be a doctor. I should have been a doctor. I said, go be a doctor. Oh, I'm too old. She's probably like 20. Oh, I'm too old for that. You're not too old for that. Go be a doctor if you've always wanted to be a doctor. There's everything right in following your dreams, everything right in trying to get a good, solid foundation, everything right for trying to reach for more. But we should always find satisfaction, which is, again, that's the hard line. Because to look for something more, all of a sudden, we're not satisfied with where we are. We say, you know what? My goal is going to be to double my salary in 10 years, whatever. Like, I'd have a 10-year goal. I don't even have a 10-minute goal. But we're supposed to have, like, 10-year goals. I'm gonna have this position in my work in the next 2 years. I'm going to work my hardest so I can get this position in 2 years. And if you don't get that position in 2 years, are you still satisfied with where you were and where you are? No. Now that's the most miserable job you could ever imagine. But you wanted that job. You remember so excited, how excited you were when you went to the job interview and you waited for the call and then, oh, am I going to get the, oh, I got the job. And you go out to IHOP and have a celebratory pancake. And then 6 months later, it's the worst job you ever had. Oh, I hate my job. If I could only get out of my job. I hate my boss. My coworkers are morons. You hated everything about it. You hate. But if I had this job, then I'd be happy. Oh, I'd be so happy. This guy's got it easy. And then you get that job. Are you happy? No. Because that discontent spirit is still in you. So I think the whole trick of this, the lesson to be learned, is somehow trying to find satisfaction wherever we are while still trying to reach for more. Not because it's going to bring us happiness, but because there's nothing wrong with it. Look at the next passage here. I think this sums it up. 1 Corinthians 7:17. Nevertheless, Paul is speaking to the church in Corinth. So now we're in the New Testament. Paul is writing letters to churches, telling churches how to live. So this is applicable directly to us. Nevertheless, each person should live as a believer in whatever situation the Lord has assigned to them, just as God has called them. Were you a slave when you were called by God? Did you get saved as a slave? There was still slavery then, but again, it was a different kind of slavery. Were you a slave when you were called by God? Don't let it bother you. But if you can gain your freedom, do so. I think that perfectly sums it up. Be satisfied with whatever situation you're in. Now, if you can get in a better situation, go for it. But whatever situation you are in, don't let it bother you. And if Gehazi just would have recognized, you know what, I'm a servant. I'm an assistant, basically. I'm an assistant of Elisha. That should have been an awesome responsibility. That should have been a great thing. You think Gehazi was super psyched when he got appointed the servant of Elisha? Elisha, double the spirit of Elijah, can pick anybody to be on his basketball team. And everyone's going, ooh, ooh, ooh. Remember in school when they were picking you on the basketball team and you hope you didn't get picked last? Oh, you didn't want to get picked last. Oh, you'd cut up, pretend you're not paying attention and thinking, oh, please pick me. Please let a captain be picked that's a friend of mine so they can pick me. Elisha could have picked anybody, anybody. God's spirit and power was all over him. And he looked around and he said, oh, I want that one. And that one was like, oh, I am so psyched. This is so awesome. And then how long passes where he is suddenly not content in his position anymore? There's nothing wrong with wanting more. If you can get that, you know, he's saying, if you have this job, be happy with it. If you can get a better one, awesome. But as long as you have this one, be satisfied in the position that you are. But you are, Babs. Okay, next slide. Don't take three things for granted, and then we're, oh, I'm already out of time? Oh, barely out of time, so I'm all right. I wasn't watching the clock, sorry. Three things. Don't take your gifts for granted. You know that when you got saved, when you gave your life to the Lord, you got a gift from God. That's an awesome thought. We have to do a thing on spiritual gifts sometimes. But you got a specific gift, maybe a few gifts, from God. You didn't have them before you got saved. When you gave your life to the Lord, God said, ooh, ooh, open mind. And he gave you a gift, and it may be the gift of teaching. It may be the gift of mercy. It may be the gift of giving. It's a gift that you can use in your ministry to give to someone else. It may be the gift of helps, the Bible says, where you're more behind the scene, just helping any way you can. That's probably like Gehazi. But instead of appreciating the gift he was given, he wanted the other gift. I want tongues. I want healing. I want, what's that other cool, miraculous one? I want that one. Where some churches say if you don't have a particular gift, you're not even saved. That's craziness. That's hogwash. God gave you a gift, and he gave you a different one. And he gave you a different one because we're all one body. And the Bible says we don't need a bunch of noses. Then we'd be a bunch of nosy people. We don't need to all be noses. If we're all noses, well, who's going to hear? Some of us are ears. Some of us are noses. Some of us are little patitas, little feet for you English people, little feet. Some of you are little hands. Some of you are the brains. That's my baby. We all have different parts. And for a foot to say, I don't want to be a foot. Everybody's always stepping on me. I want to be a head. Then the body doesn't work well together. And the Bible says that some of the hidden parts, like the pancreas, those might be the most important part. You can't live without it. I mean, you could live without a pinky. But the pinky, everybody likes the pinky. I'm going to get a pinky ring, and I'm going to look cool. But the appendix, well, you can't even see the appendix. What does the appendix do? Everybody says, well, I don't think it does anything. I'm just going to take it out. I bet it does something. They used to think tonsils didn't do anything. So when my mom was a kid, everybody got their tonsils out. Because what does it do? It just gets infected. Well, they found out it was a very important part of the immune system to try to keep infection from getting deeper into your body. That's probably what the appendix does too. It probably holds on to stuff. And that's why it gets infected, because it gets all bogged down with stuff. Anyway, that's a whole other thing. Don't take your gifts for granted. God has given you a gift that gives you a perspective for ministry, as Tony has said before, and a power for ministry. Whatever you're good at spiritually, that may be the gift you have. That's a whole other talk again. But just consider wherever you are in life, be happy with it and think, you know what? I'm a good listener. Well, maybe you have the gift of mercy or of encouragement. Those are gifts. Don't take your gifts for granted. Don't take your godly relationships for granted. What an amazing position Gehazi was in to be the right-hand man of Elisha. What an amazing spiritual position to be able to be mentored by Elisha. You know, people leave this church. It's the funniest thing. Sorry, babe, it's not really funny. People leave this church mad at Tony. Everybody who leaves this church, by the way, is always mad at Tony. It's always Tony's fault. Poor Tony. But because Tony tells them. And they say, I'm sorry, but you shouldn't be living with her. It's none of your business. You don't know my get out. Step back. And they always leave like little girls. Not really. They don't always leave like little girls. They might be watching. So they leave. And then, no kidding, guys that have threatened to hit him before they've left, they'll call him on the phone and say, hey, Tony, I have a Bible question. It's like, okay, that's cool that you're reading the Bible and you have a question, but where are you going to church? Oh, I go to Calvary. Ask Skip. Oh, you can't get to Skip. They would call him like once a week asking these Bible questions. He's like, dude, I'm not your pastor. Well, but I can't get to my pastor and I can always get to you. Well, sorry, but you left. You left our ministry. Go get fed in your church. Don't take the godly relationships you have for granted. We have direct access to the man. I have especially direct access to the man. Yes. Don't take your gifts for granted. Don't take your godly relationships for granted. Don't take God for granted. Did Gehazi really think that no one was going to see him? That God wasn't going to punish him? Every time we get busted like that little kitty or like the dog, hey, woof, I'm right here, Mama. I've been here all the time while you've been typing on that keyboard. Like, we're not going to get caught. Learn from these examples so that we don't get caught up in the same thing they did. Because the Bible says that the same temptation that overtook them, guess what? It's going to be the same one that overtakes us. There's nothing new. The same thing. Us checking out that dude Jim from out of the pool and all of us going, ugh. The same thing's going to, not me, of course, is going to overtake us all. So let's learn from these guys, this lack of Bible character. Let's learn from them so that we don't get tripped up by the same thing. Cool? All right, let's pray. Lord Jesus, thank you for your word. Thank you for giving us these incredible examples where we can read their accounts and think, how could they be so stupid, but all the while knowing that we do the same things. God, help us learn. When we're starting to feel discontent in our situation, help us find contentment. Like Paul said, learning to be content in whatever situation, whether he had a lot or had very little, he learned to find contentment. God, help us learn to be content in whatever situation we're in. God, help us never get our eyes off the fact that all that matters in this life is serving you. God, help us never take your gifts for granted. Help us never take the godly relationships in our life for granted. And God, above else, help us never take you for granted. We love you, Jesus, and we praise you. In your name we pray. Amen. Stuck out in the middle of